So next step would then be the Java virtual machine. So the question? Oh, okay. So the original design goal by Google for Android was to provide support for many different hardware platforms without having to recompile apps and applications every time. So most phones which you can buy now are still based on ARM processors, but there are different sorts of ARM processors. There are also some phones with Intel processors. Very rarely you can also see MIPS processors. So there's all our different architectures, and if you wanted to support them all, you would have to recompile your apps for every single architecture, and that's of course not helping with in terms of having a wide reach. So the idea here is to use some kind of virtual machine, and luckily in a sense Google didn't try to reinvent the wheel here, so they based this on Java. Java already provides the entire virtual machine. It has this kind of assembler-like bytecode, which is independent from the machine and just written for the virtual machine. The problem was that Java always had a kind of bad reputation that it uses lots of resources, lots of RAM, lots of CPU, and so on. And for that reason, also, Google introduced their own adaptation of the Java virtual machine, which is called Dalvik. Dalvik is a Norwegian fishing village. I don't know the exact reason. I think one of the developers was born there or something like that. But if you ever wonder what that name means, it's a fishing village. So in any case, there's one subtle difference between the regular Java virtual machine and Dalvik, and that is that the regular VM is based simply on a stack. So this means that you can have a very simple compiler. And in fact, on many university graduate courses on compiler construction, basically build a simple Java compiler, because it's really not that difficult if you have a stack-based virtual machine. The drawback is that you need lots of RAM access. So you always need to put things on the stack and pop things back off the stack and do this all the time. And so you get lots of RAM access. And this is one of the reasons why Java in general is rumored to be slow. On the other hand, if you now have a register-based virtual machine, that is something that's closer to the actual physical processor, which the thing is running on, because physical processors also always have registers. And that means if you have those registers already in hardware, then you can sometimes directly map them to the virtual machine and store intermediate values much faster. For example, you don't have to do push and pop on the stack in memory again. So there's a much better mapping between the virtual machine and the actual hardware, and that can help speed things up. The big drawback is that the compiler is a lot more complex. So you need to keep track of the different registers and where you actually put your intermediate values. You can't just put everything on the stack and back off again. So it needs much more effort up front, but then at runtime, it's generally supposed to be faster. So there's actually Dalvik has been kind of supplemented by now by ART, Android Runtime Simply. The general idea of Dalvik, I already mentioned that, is that it's register-based instead of stack-based, and it also had a just-in-time compiler until Android 4.4. That means that it actually, instead of running everything on the virtual machine, it tried to identify performance-critical sections with maybe the inner part of a loop, and then converted those parts directly to native machine code on the fly, and basically run those parts outside of the virtual machine directly on the processor, so that would speed things up. One problem, of course, is with this kind of just-in-time compilation is that it will take some additional time when it's run for the first time, so that that might sometimes cause the application to basically stall a little while the just-in-time compiler is running and only then continue. And for that reason, from Android 5.0, the basically improved Delvik version Android runtime uses a so-called ahead-of-time compiler. And that means as soon as you install an app, then it will basically compile the Java bytecode to a native executable directly on your device. The drawback, of course, is that this will need more space because you just can't just keep around the bytecode. You also need the native executable that's being created on the device. On the plus side, you get higher execution speed. I'll try to illustrate this here a little. So how does the process work? When you develop an app, you start, of course, out with the source code. Source code is then converted via several steps to a so-called DEX file. Maybe you've already seen these. This is combined with stuff like the images, resources, UI elements, and so on. It's just zipped together, and the result is an APK file. So you can open up any APK file with a archive viewer, it's just a zip file, and see what's actually inside there. And then when it's being installed, it's basically split up again into resources and the DEX file. And then, depending on whether you have an older Android version running only Delvik or a newer one running AOT, then what happens is either that this DEX file is optimized into a so-called ODEX, optimized DEX file, which is then run on Delvik, or on the newer one, it's directly compiled into an ELF file containing native code, which is then directly executed on the processor itself. And what's making things even a little more complicated now is that inside your APK, you can actually also have native code. So code that's directly being compiled already at development time for the specific processor in your device. I'll go into detail later on, but the general idea is that if you have stuff which you already know that's performance critical, like image processing, for example, then you can put it into a native library. And get a little more control over how the performance is actually optimized. And this native code is, of course, directly executed on the processor. And depending on what variant of the virtual machine you use, it's either compiled at runtime with Delvik or in advance with ART. So this for a kind of overview. Now, why go to all this trouble? It's actually quite a big performance boost. So if you compare Delvik and ART, there's no scenario where ART is slower. It's always faster, sometimes not much, sometimes almost by a factor of not exactly 3, like maybe 2.5. So it's always a big speed advantage because you always have native code running directly on the processor as opposed to the virtual machine. The virtual machine is still there, but it's not really actually being used at runtime anymore. So I'll jump ahead to this question here. Why do you think does this conversion to native code and the virtual machine and so on, why does all of this happen on the device? Why do we have to be so complicated? Yeah.
Because it's device specific. I mean, as long as you want to be cross-platform, mm-hmm. you have to know the device you're working on in order to compile it to this.
Exactly. So yeah, to still be cross-platform, you actually need this virtual machine. And then on each device, you have one device-specific compiler, which is maybe even optimized for that specific processor and so on. Otherwise, you would have to basically compile your application for every processor which could somehow be inside a phone. And that's, I don't know, 20 or 30 different processor families. And as soon as somebody comes up with a new one, then you would actually have to recompile your app once again. So it's much more efficient and much more easy for a broad distribution to do it on the phone itself. So, yeah. Yes, yes. Native code is always device specific. So if you want to do that optimization really upfront and build native code yourself, then you need to build it for every device you want to support. So often the way it's done, as I understand it in many apps, is that they select maybe the two or three most common processor families and build the native code only for them. And for the rest, it simply doesn't work, or you maybe get a fallback with virtual machine code. But that's, of course, a lot slower then.
So that's more or less a thing only a really big company would do using native code?
Either big company, or if you really need the performance and you know that it's, for example, if you do some kind of research prototype and you already know that it's going to run on a Nexus 6, then you can, of course, just build the native code for the Nexus 6 and be done with it. So I already mentioned that there are a few more steps to actually get from the Java code to the APK file. So the first step is actually that you just take the Java source code, then run it through the Java C compiler and get a class file. That's basically still the same as with regular Java. Next step is then to take all these class files and run them through DX, which will then produce this Delvik executable. And what DX does is, on the one hand, it converts the bytecode so that it's now register-based. So the Java compiler still creates bytecode for a stack-based virtual machine. And DX then converts that into bytecode for the Delvik virtual machine, which is register-based. And it also tries to compress everything a little by removing duplicate strings and so on. And then, yeah, the DEX files, the resources, and everything else, is packaged together into a zip file, and this zip file is then simply gets the extension APK, and this can then be pushed to your device, uploaded to the store, and so on. Okay, so now, we already talked about native compilation. Android does have tools for that. So, of course, you're all familiar with the SDK, which is just the big bunch of Java interfaces, Java components, which you need to build regular applications based on the virtual machine alone. But there's also the NDK, the Native Development Kit, in addition. Which contains a dedicated C++ compiler and the libraries, and which is then optimized, for example, to work with Bionic, to not rely on the standard libc, but to actually be able to use Bionic. Sometimes when you want to compile an existing C++ library or C library with the NDK, you will still run into little problems and make little adjustments, but in general, it's possible at least to just compile a existing C++ library and then use it in your application. For this to work, of course, you also need to implement some kind of Java native interface, which creates a bridge between the Java parts of your application, because anything which you see on the screen basically has to be built in Java. All the user interface elements, all of this is only accessible through the virtual machine, basically. But again, for performance-specific stuff, you can then also access things that are written in native code in C or C++, and for that, you have the NDK. Actually, it's maybe an interesting point is that with ART, the number of use cases where you actually need the NDK has gotten a little smaller, because since it's compiled to native code anyway, it will often get similar performance as directly using native code.
Sorry.
Yeah, because ART actually creates native code in the end. It's often actually difficult to beat the performance gain you get from that by switching to native code, only if you have very specific scenarios like maybe image processing or something like that, then it still makes sense to go back to doing the native code conversion by yourself. Okay, yeah, question.
But are these ports like the other virtual machine actually equivalent? Because I think some features of like Java, for example, runtime, factoring, runtime, like there's a lot of features that actually depends on the Java virtual machine itself.
Yes. So, but all of this is basically all the Java libraries are then, when ART compiles everything to native code, then the Java libraries, or at least those Java libraries used by the app, are also converted. So they're basically linked into the resulting binary, and everything is packaged together and also converted to native code. I'm not 100% sure right now. I think that most of the Java libraries which you use every day, Java, Lang, I don't know, String or whatever, actually already exist as native libraries on the device and are then simply also linked into the resulting binary. So the general idea behind ART is that it doesn't actually have to execute anything on the virtual machine anymore at runtime, but it all happens as soon as you install the app. And the resulting binary is then basically executed natively every time.
Another question.
Yeah?
Would it be possible for like an application on ART, which is at the end would be compiled to communicate with another native code? Because
yes. So Binder, for example, also exists. So this is exactly the same inter-process communication happens exactly the same way. So that hasn't changed at all. So they still can, so one app can be a service and one app can be a front end basically and call that service. So works exactly the same. Other questions about this whole development process thing?